Dear students, today we are going to discuss electrocardiography. Electrocardiography means that electrical activity of the heart is graphically presented. What is it? ECG? ECG means electrical activity of the heart is graphically presented, or graphic presentation of electrical activity of the heart. So, to really understand the fundamentals of ECG, you must first understand the electrical activity of the heart, right? So, let's talk few words about the electrical activity in the myocardial cells. Here I draw three ventricular myocardial cells, and we see what is the electrical activity normally in these cells. Let's suppose this is first myocardial cells, ventricular myocardial, this is second cell, and this is the third cell, right? And we see how the electrical activity goes through that, right? Then we'll discuss how that electrical activity can be eventually translated into ECG pattern. Fine? Let's suppose that right now these myocardial cells are not stimulated. They are unstimulated. There is no action potential passing through them. Is that right? So we say these myocardial cells are resting. If this cell is electrically resting, right, it must have resting membrane potential. Now, what is resting membrane potential? Resting membrane potential is the electrical voltage difference between the inside of the membrane and outside of the membrane. Normally, resting cells of the ventricular myocardium are electrically negative inside, right? For example, the resting membrane potential is minus 90 millivolt in a resting cell. When I say this myocardial cell has minus 90 millivolt resting membrane potential, I mean that in the resting condition, this myocardial cell has its membrane internally polarized negatively, right? Now, what really happens that as soon as the cell is stimulated, right? Now, when there is appropriate stimulation to a myocardial cell, suppose ventricular myocardial cell, if there is appropriate stimulation, what will happen? That its resting membrane potential will reach to the threshold, right? As I said, resting membrane potential is minus 90 millivolt, is that right? And this is minus 90. If we stimulate the cell, then some cations will come in, some positive charges will come in. Let's suppose that we bring some sodium or calcium ions in. If we bring some electropositive ions in, what will happen? That this electropositivity which is coming into cell after the stimulation, this will take the resting membrane potential towards less negative value, because these positive charges will neutralize the electronegativity. Is that right? To some extent. So what really happens, as soon as positive charges are coming in, resting membrane potential is becoming less negative. For example, it become minus 80 and then it become minus 70 millivolt, right? Now, as soon as resting membrane potential from minus 90 millivolt, right, it moves towards the threshold potential. And let's suppose in this cell, threshold potential is minus 70, right? Threshold potential is a potential at which membrane of this cell will suddenly open voltage gated sodium channels. These are voltage gated sodium channels, and right now these channels are off. These channels are not working. But as soon as you stimulate the cell and some cations are coming in, resting membrane potential start moving towards threshold. As soon as it touches the threshold, voltage gated sodium channels open up. As soon as voltage gated sodium channels open in the cell membrane, lot of sodium comes in. Lot of sodium is coming in. Why? Because normally sodium is more outside the cell. Is that right? And normally cell is electrically negative inside. So as soon as the resting magnetic potential goes to the threshold voltage, right, then voltage sensitive, sodium channels open, a lot of sodium comes in. This sodium, as it is rapidly coming into cell, is progressively neutralizing the electronegativity. And this threshold potential, which was minus 70, it will become minus 60, minus 50, minus 40, and eventually it will become zero. It means as more and more sodium is coming in, this membrane potential is progressively going towards positive value. Initially it is losing the electronegativity and eventually it may become positive. For example, it is minus 60, minus 50, 40, 30, 20, minus 10, 0, and even it may become plus 10. So what has happened? That once the voltage gated sodium channels open, lot of sodiums come in, this movement of sodium inside, right, neutralizes the resting magnetic potential and take it towards electropositivity. And we say the membrane, which was previously negatively polarized, it has lost its negative polarity. What has happened? On appropriate stimulation, lot of cations came in, and these incoming cations neutralize the electronegativity of the membrane. So inside of the membrane, right, which was initially negatively polarized, it has lost its negative polarity. Or we simply say membrane is depolarized. When membrane loses its negative polarity, we say membrane is, yes please, membrane is depolarized. So this event is called depolarization current. Once depolarizing current is produced and we say cell is depolarized, what is the next electrical event? Next event is the depolarization sensitive depolarization sensitive calcium channels and potassium channel both start opening. Right? Now, these red channels are calcium channels and this green channels are potassium channels. Right? And you must be knowing that in a normal healthy cell, right, it has, its normal healthy cell is very, very rich in potassium. Intracellular potassium is normally more as compared to the extracellular potassium. And extracellular calcium is more normally as compared to intracellular calcium. Now what really happens? Listen, you stimulated the cell, cell underwent lot of sodium influx, that led to phenomenon of depolarization, then depolarization sensitive calcium channel, then potassium channels opened. When potassium channels opened, I told you inside of the cell is very rich in potassium. So potassium will start leaking outward. What is happening? Potassium will start moving outward. There is efflux of potassium. As soon as efflux of the potassium start, it means cells start losing cations. Cells start losing cation. It comes towards the electronegativity. But as soon as it is around zero voltage, calcium channels also open. So for some time, for a very short time, potassium keep on moving out, and as calcium channels are open, so calcium keep on moving in. It means for a brief duration, potassium as positive charges are lost and calcium as positive charges are gained to the inside of the cell. So it means for a brief duration, cations are lost as potassium as well as cations are gained as calcium. So loss and gain of calcium balances the potential, right? What really happens that as potassium is being lost, at the same time calcium is being gained, so there is no net change in potential. But as time passes by, calcium channel close. As time is passing by, calcium channels start closing. But as time passes by, potassium channels become more and more active. So what is the result? That by this time, no more calcium is coming in. But because potassium channels have become more active, so potassium losses become very, very heavy. There's a heavy potassium efflux. And as more and more potassium is going out, it means more and more positive charges are going out. It means cell will again start developing electronegativity because cell is losing the positive potassium. So when potassium keep on moving out, what really happens? That cells, due to loss of positively charged potassium, become progressively electronegative. And potassium is progressively being lost. Potassium is being lost until membrane potential again becomes at which value? Resting membrane potential value, that is minus 90 millivolt. Is that right? So what happened during this time? What happens really? That electrically membrane has come back to its negative polarization. If membrane has come back to its negative polarization, it means membrane is repolarized. Due to potassium efflux, membrane has gone to the phenomenon of repolarization. Let's revise it again. What really happens? This was a resting myocardial cell. It was having resting membrane potential of minus 90 millivolt. Is that right? When it was appropriately stimulated, some cations trickled in, entered in. These cations took the resting membrane potential at threshold potential. At threshold potential, voltage gated sodium channels open. Lot of sodium comes in and then potential goes towards the, it loses all the electronegativity and goes towards the positive side. This phenomenon is called, membrane is undergoing which phenomenon?
Depolarization.
Membrane is depolarized. After depolarization, in ventricular and atrial cells, repolarization process start. In repolarization process, initially potassium goes out, but very soon calcium start coming in. For a brief time, potassium is going out, but at the same time calcium is coming in, so cations are lost as well as cations are gained. So there is no voltage difference. So we say that electrical potential is showing plateau phase, but eventually calcium channels shut down and potassium channels become progressively more open. So a lot of potassium leaks out, and due to heavy losses of positive ions, right, membrane become progressively electronegative inside, and potassium keep on going out until the membrane voltage goes back to its resting negatively polarized state. So we say that there is, membrane has gone under the phenomenon of repolarization. So these two processes together, they are called depolarization and repolarization. Is that right? So by stimulation, we say this cell number one has undergone process of depolarization, and after the depolarization, it has undergone repolarization. Is that right? Once this cell went under depolarization, once the cell it was undergoing depolarization due to sodium influx, right? The sodium which was coming to the cell, some of this sodium through gap junctions, these are very special connections between the adjacent myocardial cells. Adjacent myocardial cells, neighboring myocardial cells have electrical windows. So what happens? When one cell undergo depolarization, the cations which have come into the cell, some of these cations trickle to the next cell. From here they go to the next cell. When cations from the first stimulated cell trickle into next cell, what really happens? Then resting membrane potential of the next cell will reach up to, yes please, reach up to threshold. And then what will happen? Voltage gated sodium channels will open into this. Then same thing will happen for short time. Voltage gated calcium and potassium channels will be open simultaneously. Eventually calcium channel stop, but potassium channel keep on working, and losses of potassium eventually take the membrane potential back to its resting situation. So it means depolarization of one cell led to the depolarization of second cell. And when second cell is depolarized, when second cell gains lot of cations, it trickles the cations into third cell, and then third cell undergoes the process of depolarization and repolarization. It means that this fluctuating potential of the membrane right? The membrane fluctuates from resting membrane potential to depolarization, and then it fluctuates back to repolarization. This depolarization and repolarization, they are moving in the cell membranes. Because depolarization and repolarization are moving, so this fluctuation, total electrical fluctuation of depolarization and repolarization, because it is mobile, it is called action potential. Is that right? Let me write it more clearly. That there is, yes, resting membrane potential, and with proper stimulation, there is stimulation. Resting membrane potential will lead to the membrane to, yes please, depolarization. Then depolarization will stimulate initially calcium and potassium channels, but eventually potassium channels become very active and a lot of potassium goes out, and that leads to repolarization. And as depolarization and repolarization are moving on the membrane, so both of them together, they are called action, yes please, action potential. Is that right? So in next discussion, when I say that cells are undergoing depolarization, it means cell is gaining cations, usually sodium in case of atrial and ventricular cells, they undergo, during depolarization they gain sodium cations, right? And if there is special point, if there is depolarization of SA node and AV node, remember, depolarization of SA node and AV node is not sodium dependent, that is calcium dependent. So it means when I say that atrial tissue or ventricular tissue is undergoing depolarization, it means those tissues are gaining sodium. And if I say SA node and AV node are depolarizing, it means they are gaining calcium. But anyway, depolarization is whenever cell is appropriately stimulated, a lot of sodium or calcium come in and depolarizes the cell. But whenever cell is depolarized, it is followed by which activity? Repolarization. And this depolarization in one cell stimulates the next cell through the gap junctions. So next cell become depolarized. And second cell will depolarize the third cell. And third cell will depolarize the next cell. So in this way, in the heart, because every cell has electrical windows or gap junctions with the next cell, so electrical stimulation of one cell can lead to the electrical stimulation of the next cell. Am I clear? If this basic concept is clear, now we'll talk about that little bit more in detail, right? Eventually, what we have to understand today, we have to understand that how electrical activity of the heart can eventually be presented as ECG pattern. Is that right? Now, we develop some more basic concepts. Let's suppose here is your heart. These are your atrial chambers, and here we have your, yes please, ventricular chambers, right? Of course, here should be SA node, sinoatrial node, and in between the atria and ventricle, this is fibrous, what is this? Fibrous annulus, right? And the only electrical connection between the atria and ventricle is, what is this? AV node. The only electrical window between the atrial myocardium and ventricular myocardium is AV node. Is that right? So this is SA node, here it is AV node, this is atrial myocardium, and here it is ventricular myocardium, right? Now, ECG machine work on the principles of the galvanometer. ECG machine works on the principles of galvanometer. What I will do, for simplicity of the concept, I will remove one piece of myocardium from here. I will remove a piece of myocardium from ventricle and put that piece of myocardium here and apply the galvanometer machine on that. And we will see that electrical activity in that piece of myocardium, how it lead to the fluctuations in the needle of galvanometer. Let's suppose that, yes, let's suppose this is that piece of myocardium. Of course, this one piece of myocardium must have lot of myocardial cell. Is that right? It must have, yes please, lot of myocardial cells. So I'm just showing few of the myocardial cell, and again you must remember all the myocardial cells are connected with each other through electrical windows which are called gap junctions. Is that right? Now what we do, that here I put the galvanometer machine, right? Galvanometer machine, this is a very small instrument, and this instrument, electrical instrument, has one positive electrode and one negative electrode, right? And the function of this galvanometer is to detect the electrical activity in any object where it has applied its electrode. You know, galvanometer is very commonly with the people who deal with the electrical wires, and they bring this meter with two electrodes and they apply these electrodes on different ends of the wires to check that wire is dead or electrical wire is having current or live. Now, the same thing what we are doing. What we are doing, that from this piece of myocardium, ventricle, we removed a piece of myocardium, we put this piece of myocardium there, and we bring this a small galvanometer and apply its electrode there. Is that right? Now, when there is no electrical activity in this piece of myocardium, when there is no electrical activity there, the needle of this galvanometer remains at neutral position, or needle or pointer remain at zero position. If it is, right? Now, what really happens, that first of all, imagine that this is a piece of myocardium which is not stimulated. If it is not stimulated, it means this is displaying resting membrane potential. All the cells are displaying resting membrane potentials. It means all the cells are electrically negative from within. Is that right? So every cell is electrically, yes please, they are electrically negative. Is that right? Now, let's make a study. When all the cells are electrically negative, let's suppose this is, this end of the piece is A point and this end is B point. Now A side has negative electrode, B side has positive electrode, and both electrodes are trying to sense, is there any electrical activity into this myocardium or not? Because myocardium is not stimulated and all of its charges, all the cells are on the resting membrane potential, all cells are electrically negative, right, from A point up to the B point. Do you think electrical charges or electrical forces move when all the tissue is electrically negative? Remember, the electrical charges move between the negative and positive ends. Is that right? Now, when all the tissue is electronegative or resting, right, there is no movement of electrical charges. If there is no movement of electrical charges, there is no depolarization, there is no repolarization, no electrical activity, right? So both of these electrodes will report that there is no electrical activity. Do you think needle will fluctuate or remain at neutral position? Remain at neutral position. So we say that galvanometer needle under these circumstances will remain like, yeah, at zero position. Clear? Now, we repeat the interesting experiment. What we do? Again, this is the same piece of myocardium. This is A point and here it is B point. Again, here we have applied negative electrode and here we have applied, yes please, positive electrode. But this time, we stimulate this, we give some electrical stimulation to A point, right? We stimulate electrically this piece of myocardium on A side. Of course, if there is appropriate stimulation, you understand what will happen. The resting membrane potential will go towards threshold. And as soon as in this cell, the cells which are on the A side, when they are appropriately stimulated, resting membrane potential goes up to threshold. What will happen there? Suddenly, lot of voltage-gated sodium channels will open. What will happen? With appropriate stimulation, cell will be stimulated and lot of voltage-gated sodium channels will open. a lot of voltage gated sodium channels will open, then in these cells there will be sodium influx. Lot of sodium will start moving from extracellular fluid to the intracellular fluid, and cells will turn up into electropositive, because during depolarization when sodium will go in, cell will lose its negative polarity, and we say cells will become depolarized. So when cells become depolarized, they become electrically positive or negative? Yes, please. They become electrically positive. Now we can say, now these first group of cells, when they are stimulated, they undergo depolarization. Through the gap junctions, they will stimulate the next group of cells. Am I right? Then second group of cells will become electropositive. Then second group of cells will stimulate the third group of cells through the gap junctions, and third group of cells will become electropositive. So what happened really? By stimulating at this point, right, these cells at this point underwent depolarization, and then wave of depolarization start moving in the myocardial cell. And this wave of depolarization is moving like this. Is that right? Now, when wave of depolarization is moving from point A to the point B within the myocardial cells, so naturally, when we say that wave of depolarization is moving, it means that basically cation influx is going on. So positive charges are moving. Wave of depolarization moving mean? Which charges are moving? Positive charges are moving, because membranes are becoming electropositive progressively. Is that right? Right. So what we can do, that when this lot of positive charges are moving in the piece of myocardium, electromagnetic force is produced. What is produced? Electromagnetic force is produced. And you must be knowing that every force can be represented by a vector. Every force can be represented by a vector. So when this muscle is stimulated and it undergoes depolarization due to sodium influx, and this depolarizing current is a wave of sodium ions, and this electropositivity wave is moving within this, this electropositive wave or electromagnetic force can be presented by a vector. And if I make a vector here, the vector is this one. Now this vector represents this force. Pointer of the vector is pointing towards the direction in which the electrical force is moving, the direction in which depolarization is moving, the direction in which charges are moving. And in the pointer we will put positive, because these are the positive charges which are moving through this. Right? So what really happens, that this vector is representing the electrical activity in this piece of myocardium, right, or electrical force generated in the myocardium. And this vector length of the vector should be proportionate to the power of the force. If electrical force is, if depolarization is more, or electrical force is more, vector has to be long. If there is less depolarization, vector has to be small. And pointer of the vector should point the direction in which the electrical current or wave of depolarization is moving. Is that right? So here this vector is showing that wave of depolarization is moving from point A to point B. It means positive charges are moving towards the positive electrode or away from the positive electrode? Towards the positive electrode. Whenever positive charges move towards the positive electrode, needle will deflect positively. Now let me draw this here. This was the neutral position of the needle in the beginning. This is the positive side, positive 10, positive 20 voltage, positive 30, and here it is zero position, and here is minus 10, 20, minus 30. Now what really happens? When positive charges start moving towards the positive electrode, the deflection in the needle is, deflection in the needle is towards the positive side. So it means that under these circumstances, when positive vector is moving towards the positive electrode, needle will deflect to the positive side. It has moved like this. Is that right? This is the principle number one, that whenever positive charges move towards the positive electrode, needle will deflect to the positive side. Right? Number two, then another thing you are supposed to learn, that in this piece of myocardium, as we know, initially we stimulated point A, and by stimulation of point A, naturally, as we discussed, point A become electropositive. It become depolarized. Then wave of depolarization was moving from A to B. Eventually, all the piece of myocardium from point A to point B, all of it will become, yes please, all of it will become completely depolarized. When it becomes completely depolarized, do you think, when it is completely depolarized, at that very moment, do you think that there is any electrical forces moving? No. Remember, when cell is completely, when any piece of myocardium is completely resting, there is no electrical forces. Or when it is completely depolarized, right, from one point to the next point, all of it is depolarized, there is no further movement of the charges. When there is no further movement of the charges, it means then this vector will disappear. This vector will disappear and needle will go back to its neutral position. Needle will go back to its neutral position. It means when you stimulate it, as charges were moving towards positive electrode, deflection was towards positive side. By the time all of this become depolarized, right, no further movement of the charges, needle will go back to its neutral position. So we can say that in this situation, needle is again neutral. Is that right? Here was again positive electrode and negative electrode, but they could not sense anything because all of it was electropositive and no movement of the ions. Am I clear? Now let's repeat an experiment in another way. We said that when it is stimulated, right, vector is going towards the positive side and deflection is positive. Let's suppose we make the thickness of this piece of myocardium double, right? We make it double thickness and we repeat the experiment in the same fashion. Now again here is positive electrode and here it is, yes please, negative electrode, and of course in the same way this is A side and this is B side. This time myocardial tissue is double thickness. If you have increased the thickness of the myocardial, if you have increased the thickness of the myocardial tissue, then it means total number of cells will be less or more? More. So now if we or total, now you stimulate a thicker myocardium, again this point will undergo depolarization. But you tell me one thing, now in a thicker myocardium, when there is development of depolarization, less sodium is going in or more sodium is going in? More sodium is going in. When more sodium is going in, then naturally stronger vectors are produced or weaker vectors are produced? Stronger. So another principle which you have to understand, that vector length will increase because length of the vector should be directly proportional to the strength of electromagnetic field. Now look at this example and this example. In both cases, current is moving from point A to B. Is that right? But because this strip is thin, so amount of the depolarizing current is small. So vector is small. Here, myocardial tissue is larger and thicker. So when you depolarize it, the depolarizing currents are stronger, right? Because more number of cells and more membranes are undergoing depolarization, right? So vector direction is same in both cases from point A to B, but in thinner tissue, vector is smaller. In thicker tissue, vector is longer. Is that right? So it means if you put atrial, everyone knows that atrial myocardium is thin and ventricular myocardium is thick. If this is a piece of atrial myocardium, it will produce positive deflection but weak positive deflection. If this is a piece of ventricular myocardium or thick myocardium, it will also produce positive deflection because positive charges are going to the positive electrode. But this time deflection will be weak or strong? This time deflection will be really strong. That from the neutral position, it will very strongly move towards this side. Is that clear? Up to now, what did we learn? Principle number one, when all the cell is unstimulated, all the myocardium is unstimulated, there is no electrical activity going on, then galvanometer needle will not fluctuate and it will remain at neutral position. Clear? When one side of the myocardium is stimulated appropriately, wave of depolarization start moving. If wave of depolarization is moving towards the positive electrode, then deflection of the needle will be positive. Is that right? If myocardial tissue is thick, it means the wave of deposition will be stronger and vector will be stronger. So if vector is moving, electropositivity vector or depolarizing vector is moving towards the positive electrode, again deflection will be positive, but because vector is stronger as tissue was thicker, so deflection will be also larger. Am I clear? Then we have also learned one thing, that if piece of the myocardium is completely depolarized, then there is no further movement of the current and there is no more vector available. So needle will come back to its neutral position. Is that right? Now I want to check, do you really understand the basis or not? Let's repeat this experiment in another way. We put this piece of myocardium, but this time we don't stimulate from A point, this time we stimulate from, yes please, B point, right? Again, A point has the negative electrode and B point has positive electrode, but this time we stimulated the B point. Now of course then this point will get electropositive first, this will undergo depolarization, then next will undergo depolarization, and this time wave of depolarization will be moving from B end to A end. So naturally the vector will be drawn like this. That pointer of the vector is towards A point, right? Now this time we can say positive charges are moving away from the positive electrode. Positive charges are moving away from the positive electrode. Deflection should be negative. Deflection in the needle should be negative. This is neutral. This position is positive side and this position is negative side. This time needle will fluctuate in this direction. So listen carefully, this is positive electrode. If positive charges are moving towards the positive electrode, deflection is positive. If positive charges are moving away from the positive electrode, deflection is negative. Am I clear? If positive charges, total positive charges moving to the positive electrode are less in amount, vector is weak, deflection is weak. If charges which are moving are a lot more, then deflections are stronger. Clear? Another experiment, just to see that how much you understand. You know, when a piece of myocardium was initially stimulated and it got depolarized and then depolarization was traveling, the needle deflected to the positive side. Eventually all the myocardium was completely depolarized. When it was completely depolarized, then what happened? There was no current and needle which was electropositive, is that right? It went back to the neutral position. Now after depolarization, membranes go back to repolarization, right? Now let's complete the cycle of depolarization and repolarization on this trip, right? Let's hope you understand it well. This is A point with negative and this is B point with positive electrode. Let's repeat depolarization plus repolarization and understand it in a complete fashion. First we stimulated A point, it got depolarized, then wave of depolarization started moving towards from A point to B point. When this was moving towards that, initially there was deflection in which direction?
Positive.
From this, needle moved in this direction and we say there was positive deflection. But eventually, as time passed by, depolarization moves over the membrane, different membrane cells, and eventually all the myocardium has become completely, deposition started from this point and it swept over all the membrane. When depolarization was sweeping, you remember a vector was produced and that vector, positive charge is moving towards the positive electrode, so deflection was positive. Clear? And eventually when it became completely depolarized, vector disappear. right? And needle went back to its neutral position. Then after some time, process of repolarization will start. Let's suppose process of repolarization start from B point. You remember during repolarization, positive charges are lost. Let's compare. During depolarization, cell gains positive charges. During repolarization, cell loses positive charges. During depolarization, sodium goes in. During repolarization, potassium goes out. So once cells have become electropositive, then they start the process of repolarization and potassium is lost out of the cell and cells become electronegative. Let us suppose that the last point to depolarize is first to repolarize. Later I will explain this phenomenon when I explain the T wave, right? Later in lecture. But for a while you trust me that in the ventricle, the last point to depolarize is first to repolarize. Is that right? It means the last point which was depolarized was B. So myocardium at this end will repolarize first. When I say the myocardium at this end will start repolarizing, it means the myocardial cells here will start losing potassium and they will again become electronegative. So it means there is re-establishment of electronegativity on this side. And as time will pass by, repolarization will sweep from the B end towards A end. As time will pass by, repolarization will sweep from B end to A end. And this time, vector will be directed like this because charges are moving from B to A. But head of the vector will be showing negative sign. Head of the vector will show negative sign because this is progressively establishing electronegativity. Now here you have to note it. When depolarization is going on, head of the vector is showing which sign?
Positive.
And when repolarization is going on, head of the vector is showing electronegativity. Am I clear? Now you have to tell me at this moment when you can say this piece of myocardium is undergoing repolarization phenomenon and wave of repolarization is moving from point B to point A, or vector of repolarization current is representing, right, by this figure, has electronegativity in its head showing that negative charges are moving from point B towards A. So it means that negative wave is moving towards negative electrode. When repolarization is moving on this membrane, we say that negative charges or negative vector is moving towards the negative electrode. When negative move towards the negative, deflection is positive or negative?
Positive.
It is positive. Very good. Because the basic principle is when positive charges move to the positive electrode, deflection positive. When negative charges move towards the negative electrode, deflection is again positive, because similar charges moving towards a similar electrode, deflections are positive, right? So when repolarization is establishing and repolarization is approaching the negative electrode, needle will again deflect positively. Am I clear? No problem? Now, let's repeat it very rapidly, right? Let's take your own test. This is the piece of myocardium. Is that right? Here is negative electrode. Here it is positive electrode. Now you tell me one thing. If this piece of myocardium is resting, no electrical activity, what will be the deflection?
Zero.
No deflection. Then if you stimulate point A electrically, right, and positive charges start moving from point A to point B, is that right? We say positive vector is moving towards positive electrode. Deflection is
positive.
If there are less cells, vector is weak and deflection is positive, but weak positive. But if muscle is very thick, very strong vector, deflection is positive, but very strong positive. Clear? Now, if all of it become totally depolarized, no current is moving, deflection is
zero.
Neutral position. If repolarization is moving from point B to A, it means negative vector is moving towards the negative electrode. Deflection is
positive. Again
positive. Now listen carefully. I repeat another thing. If I stimulate the point B and point B gets depolarized and this wave of depolarization is moving from B to A, and this is the vector. That positive vector is moving now away from the positive electrode, or we can say that positive vector is moving now towards the negative electrode. Deflection will be negative. Is that right? Now, one more principle I want to make it clear. What is that principle? That principle is that some myocardial tissue are fast conductor and the other myocardial tissues which are slow conductor. Through some myocardial tissue, current passes slowly or with moderate velocity, and with other myocardial tissue, current passes very rapidly, right? What will be difference in needle fluctuation when velocity of the current through the myocardial piece is different? Let's discuss that. Let's suppose I've taken this piece of myocardium from the atrium. Is that right? And I've taken this piece of myocardium from the ventricle. Of course, it must be thicker. Now listen, let's suppose these are myocardial cells, but these myocardial cells do not have any very specialized conduction system, right? And these cells, one cell stimulates the next cell through the gap junction, then second cell stimulates the third cell through the gap junction, then third cell stimulates the fourth cell through the gap junctions. Is that right? So we say the movement of the depolarization is with moderate velocity in first strip. Here is the second strip. Here what happened, within these myocardial cells, okay, this was the normal myocardial cells. You remember, you must remember all the myocardial cells are connected with each other through the electrical windows which are called gap junctions. That is why, because if you stimulate one myocardial cells, many other are also stimulated. We say electrically myocardial cells are a network. Electrically myocardial cells are a network, or we say myocardial cells behave as a sensation or sensitium. Now listen, within these cells we put some very special cell. This is a very special cell. It is wide diameter cell, and this group of cells within this piece. Now we have put these blue cells in these red cells. The property of blue cells are they are very large, so they offer less resistance to the current flow, and blue cells with each other have more gap junctions than the other cells. So current can move through the blue cells very rapidly. We say this is fast conducting. What is this? This is fast conducting network of myocardial cells. Such cells in the real heart are called Purkinje cells or Purkinje system. Now, this myocardial piece does not have fast conducting myocardium, but this myocardial piece has specialized fast conducting myocardium. So when depolarization moves through this tissue, it moves with moderate velocity. But when depolarization moves through this tissue, it moves with a high velocity. Am I clear? For comparison purpose, we make the thickness of both pieces same. Both pieces have the same thickness, let's suppose, but this is moderate conductor and this is fast conductor. What will happen? Let's suppose you stimulate both of them on the A point. This is A point and this is B point, and this is also A point of this and B point, right? And of course you have to apply the negative electrode here and positive electrode here, negative electrode here and positive electrode here. Now if we stimulate this cell, right, of course wave of depolarization is produced in A point and move towards the B point, and that will generate a vector. Is that right? In the same way, when this cell is stimulated, right, again from A point to B point, electrical current will move, a wave of depolarization move, and again a vector is produced. Now in both cases, let's suppose vector has equal length, right? If muscles have equal thickness. Now in both cases, positive charges are moving towards the positive electrode, so deflections will be positive, but there will be a difference. That in this case, deflection will be positive, but it will be with moderate velocity, right? Here, because deflection will be again positive, but because current is moving very fast, deflection will be very rapidly positive. So what is the real difference? That those myocardial tissues which conduct with the conduct the current or conduct the depolarization with moderate speed, they move the needle with moderate velocity or slowly. But those tissues in the myocardium which are specialized in fast conduction, they produce the depolarizing current or depolarizing vectors which are very fast vector. They will fluctuate the needle slowly or fastly? Fastly. Is that right? So here I will show that here needle will move from zero position to this. Here also needle will move from zero to positive side. But the only difference, here needle moved because tissue was moderately conducting, moved slowly. Here needle will move very rapidly. Am I clear? So this was the basic principles on which myocardial tissue produces vectors, and these electrical vectors are sensed by electrodes of the ECG machine or galvanometer, right? Once we have learned this very basic principle, now I will explain the real vectors, real electrical vectors which are produced in the heart during one cardiac cycle. Up to now we were studying only one piece of myocardium. Now we will study the whole heart, that during one cardiac cycle in the heart which electrical vectors are produced and how the ECG machine needle moves and draws the ECG pattern. We'll do it just after a break. Right, we have already made some basic concepts about the electrical activity of the heart. Now we will discuss first that what are the electrical events in the heart during one cardiac cycle. What is our discussion? First of all, we will discuss about the electrical events in the heart. Electrical events in heart during, yes please, during one cardiac cycle, right? And then we will see that how these electrical events in the heart translate into vectors. Is that right? How the different electrical events in the heart during one cardiac cycle translate or they lead to formation of cardiac vectors. That is cardiac vectors. And then we will see that how these cardiac vectors which are produced, these electrical vectors which are produced during one cardiac cycle, how they are translated into, yes please, ECG pattern, different waves and intervals, right? So again, we are going to discuss, further discussion is in three phases. Number one, what are the electrical events in the heart, and different electrical events during one cardiac cycle, what type of electrical vectors and cardiac vectors are produced, and eventually how those cardiac vectors are translated into ECG pattern. Let's suppose here is your heart, right? I draw a big heart here, and of course this is your which chambers? Atrial chambers. And what are here? Ventricular chambers, right? Now, you know electrical activity in the heart start with the depolarization of SA node. In a normal heart, we are going to talk about the electrical activity of normal heart, right? Previously, we discussed only activity, electrical activity in few cells. Now, we are talking about whole heart generating electrical patterns. So, at the beginning of the cardiac cycle, SA node fires, and when SA node fires, it generates the wave of depolarization. The wave of depolarization which is produced by SA node, right, let me make a simple heart here, that wave of depolarization which is generated by SA node, first of all it stimulates the cells which are near the SA node. The cells which are adjacent to the SA node, let's suppose these are the cells, first of all, they are stimulated and these cells undergo depolarization, first group of cells. And as you know, these cells will be connected with the next group of cells that will lead to depolarization of the second group of cells. And of course, then depolarization will move from the second group of the cells to the third group of cells. So as soon as SA node fires, wave of depolarization is produced, right? And this wave of depolarization, which is first produced near the SA node, right, this wave of depolarization start moving to the next group of cells. Eventually what happened, we see that electrical current or wave of depolarization is sweeping from SA node to over the, within the atrial myocardium, right, downward and leftward, right? It means atria are being depolarized downward and leftward. Why atria are depolarized downward and leftward? Because origin of depolarization, that is SA node, is present in the atria on the right side and upper side. Because in both atria, which are stimulated by the SA node, but position of the SA node is right and up. So from here, you can say electrical current is generated in this fashion, right? And these small vectors which are generated due to waves of depolarization, these vectors are moving downward and leftward. And again, you remember the right atrium and left atrium, they are syncytium. Is that right? Due to that reason, electrical current sweeps simultaneously on the right atrium and left atrium, right? Now all this, these vectors, depolarizing currents, can be added together, right? And when they are added together, then what really happens, that all of them together, they will make one single vector which is directed downward and leftward. Now this vector is representing the electromagnetic force which is produced in the heart when both atria are undergoing the process of depolarization, and both atria are having the spread of depolarization. So this is atrial depolarization vector, right? Now atria are thin, atrial myocardium is thin. Because atrial myocardium is thin, so this vector will be small. Secondly, atria do not have very specialized and very fast conducting system. Atria undergo depolarization moderately. So we say there is a small vector which is moving downward and leftward. Is that right? And with moderate velocity. This is the first electrical event in the heart during the cardiac cycle. What is the first electrical event? Atrial depolarization. Is that right? And that is represented by, atrial depolarization is represented by a vector, which is small vector, small depolarizing vector, moving downward and leftward with moderate velocity. Am I clear? This is the first electrical event. So in a simple diagram, we can represent the first electrical event like this. Right? So this is your first electrical event. Clear? After that, when both atria are completely depolarized, right? When atria, both atria are completely depolarized, then what happens? That these depolarizing waves will hit the fibrous annulus. Now this fibrous tissue, which is present between the atria and ventricle, this is not a very good conductor. So most of the depolarizing current which hit this fibrous partition, right, that will die out. Because from here, from these points, depolarization cannot go down. The only single point from where depolarization can go from atria down to the ventricle is AV node. What is that point? Yes, please. AV node. The only electrical window between the atria and ventricle is AV node. So all the electrical depolarizing currents which hit to the fibrous septum, they will be dead. The only those electrical depolarizations which hit the AV node, they will be taking the current gradually to the ventricle. Is that right? So first electrical event is depolarization of atria, which is represented by a small vector moving downward and leftward, right? Small depolarizing vector moving downward and leftward with moderate velocity. The second electrical event is that stimulation of AV node. What is the second electrical event? That is stimulation of AV node. Now, let me draw the AV node as a large tissue. Let's suppose this is the AV node. Now, AV node has a very special specialization. AV node is modified myocardium. It is a specialized myocardium. And AV node has specialized in slow conduction. AV node is specialized in slow conduction because when atrial current touches the AV node, AV node conduct the current very, very slowly, so that current takes or depolarization take about 0.1 second just to reach from atrium to the ventricle. Why current is slowed down at the junction of atria and ventricle at the point of AV node? Why current is slowed down? Why velocity of depolarization becomes slow? There's a reason for that. Because now atria are contracting. If current is held in AV node or stopped in AV node for a while, that is good. So that atria complete their contraction and fill the ventricles. Only when atria has completed their contraction, then electrically ventricles should be stimulated so that ventricles start contracting. Is that right? First atria should contract, after that ventricles should contract. Due to that reason, when atria are electrically stimulated, right, current is passed through the AV node very, very slowly down to the ventricle. Is that right? So AV node is specialized in slow conduction. AV node is specialized in slow conduction. Now, how AV node is specialized in slow conduction? There are many reasons. Number one, let's suppose we talk about two tissues in the heart. Number one, AV node, which is specialized in slow conduction, and later on I will explain this is Purkinje system. And this Purkinje system, right bundle branch and left bundle branch and its Purkinje fibers, this is also a specialized myocardial cells, and this tissue is specialized in fast conduction. Again, AV node is specialized in slow conduction, and bundle branches and their Purkinje fibers are specialized in fast conduction. Why this is specialized in slow conduction? So that current from while it is jumping from atria to the ventricle, it should be held here for a while until atria complete their contraction. And why after that, when current from AV node is released into ventricle, why in the ventricle there is a very fast conducting tissue? Because all the ventricles should get electrical stimulation at almost simultaneous time, so that septum of the ventricle, major part of the ventricle and basal part of the ventricle, all of them contract at almost simultaneous time, so that there should be effective ventricular output. Is that right? Now, why AV node is slow conductor and why Purkinje system is fast conduction? Let me tell you. Let's suppose AV node is 0.1 to 0.2 and Purkinje fibers are, this is Purkinje tissue, it has cells and these are Purkinje cells, these three cells I show, these are for example from 0.3 to 0.4, right? Now, this tissue is slow conductor, right? And this is Purkinje system, which is, yes please, fast conductor. Why AV node is slow? Because number one, AV node has very, very small cells, and these cells are arranged in such a way that cells are not, you can say, listen again, these are AV nodal cells. AV node has lot of cells, but these are very small cells, and these cells are arranged right angle to the direction of current flow. This is Purkinje system. Current has to move in this direction. Let's suppose depolarization has to move in this direction and in this direction. Now, in AV nodal there are many cells and small cells. In Purkinje system, there are large cells and less cells. So because point A to point 2, right, there are more cells involved, so more membranes to be crossed, so it is slow conduction. Here there are large cells and there are less cells involved, so less membranes involved in electrical event, so conduction will be fast. This is one reason. Second reason is the gap, number of gap junctions between the AV nodal cells are very, very less, but number of gap junctions between Purkinje cells are too much. So we can say that electrical windows between the AV nodal cells are very few, but electrical windows between the Purkinje cells are too many. So naturally, current will conduct from one cell to the next cell slowly in AV nodal system, but current will conduct from one cell to the next cell very fastly in Purkinje system. Is that right? Then another thing. AV node depolarization is dependent on calcium, and depolarization in Purkinje system is dependent on sodium. Calcium channel works slowly, sodium channels work fastly. So in AV node, yes, current movement is slow, and in case of Purkinje system, current movement is fast. Then the most and another important point, AV nodal cells are less diameter cells, right? So they offer more resistance to the current movement. But Purkinje cells have wide diameter, because they are very wide diameter, so even within the cell, the current has less resistance to the movement, so current moves fastly. And now we come to the most important point. What is the most important point that this is slow conductor and that is fast conductor is that AV nodal cell resting membrane potential is minus 60 millivolt, but Purkinje system cell has a resting membrane potential of minus 90 millivolt. So which cell is more electronegative, AV nodal cell or Purkinje cell? Purkinje cell is more electronegative. Now, if cations have to move into AV nodal cell as well as cations have to move in Purkinje cells, where the cations will move very rapidly in the cell which is more electronegative, because this is the electronegativity of the cell which attract the cations during depolarization. So depolarizing current in AV node are slow and depolarizing current in Purkinje systems are fast. So due to all these factors combined together, AV node is a specialized in very, very slow conduction, and Purkinje system is specialized in very, very fast conduction. So once you have understood this, now we come back to the next electrical event, right? First electrical event was, yes please, what was first electrical event? That was atrial depolarization. And let me draw a heart here. Okay, let me draw a smaller heart. Yeah. Right, this is the fibrous septum between the or annulus. Now what is here? This is left ventricle and this is right ventricle, right? And here is your friend SA node. Is that right? The first electrical event was that SA node produced the depolarization, and there were atrial depolarization, and atrial depolarization was represented by a small vector, depolarizing vector moving downward and leftward with modest velocity. Now the second important event is, yes, current passing through AV node. This is the second electrical event. I told you that AV node is a fast conductor or slow conductor. It is extremely slow conductor. This is point number one. And point number two, as compared to the rest of the heart, AV node is a large tissue or small tissue? Small tissue. AV node is a very tiny myocardial tissue, very small tissue. So when current is moving through the AV node, do you think AV nodal depolarization will produce a very big vector or very small vector? It will make a very small vector, right? Because AV node is a very tiny myocardial tissue. So when depolarizing current is passing through the AV node, number one, that current is passing through very, very slowly. And number two, that AV node is a very tiny tissue, very small tissue. So electrical vector is very, very small when AV node is undergoing depolarization process. And because the electrical vector is very small, that ECG machine will not pick that up. When ECG machine does not pick the electrical activity of AV node, right? So actually, for practical purposes, when a very miniature depolarization is passing through AV node, heart is electrically silent. You get it? You say that AV node just whispers, it does not talk. And our machine cannot hear AV nodal electrical activity. So we can say, for practical purposes, I put a question mark, that electrical activity is there, but it is so small electrical activity that our machines cannot pick up, right? So we can say that there is electrical silence in the heart. When AV node is passing through depolarization process, when AV node conduction is going on, we say heart is electrically silent. Heart is electrically silent. Is that right? So for about 0.1 second, or the duration for which current is passing through AV node, heart become electrically silent and no significant electrical vector is produced to fluctuate the needle. Is that right? Now we come to the next cardiac event. Next electrical event in the cardiac cycle is that now current has come to, yes please, where it has reached? To? Purkinje system. Through bundle of his, current will come to the right bundle branch and it will go to the, yes please, left bundle branch. And these bundle branches are made of specialized myocardial cells which are called Purkinje cells. And Purkinje cells are specialized in slow conduction or fast conduction? These are specialized in fast conduction. Is that right? Now, listen carefully. That the current, electrical current, as soon as it is released by AV node into Purkinje system, first they will depolarize the septum of the ventricle, then the current will go to the major portions of the ventricles, and this is the apex of the ventricle and this is the base of the ventricle. As current is, yes, current means depolarizing current. As depolarizing current enters into ventricles through the bundle of His and bundle branches, the first portion to be depolarized are septum of the ventricle, interventricular septum. The next portion which will be depolarized is major part of the ventricle. And last portion of the ventricle which receives the current, because current is moving like this and like this, this is the base of the ventricle. Remember, this is the apex, this is the base of the ventricle. So it means that ventricle depolarizes in three stages. First, there is a very rapid stage of septal depolarization, then major ventricular depolarization and basal depolarization. I will analyze the depolarization of every stage one by one and make their vectorial analysis. Let's make another separate diagram to understand. Okay. Let's suppose this is the interventricular septum and this is the left ventricle and here it is right ventricle. This is the right ventricular myocardium. Right, this is the left ventricular myocardium, and let's suppose that here it is your friend AV node. Naturally, when current was passing through AV node, heart was electrically silent. Then current was released through bundle of His to, yes, it is released where? To the bundle branches. And these bundle branches will take the current to the septum, right? Now, first I will show you how the ventricular septum undergoes depolarization. Now, this is the septal myocardium. Remember, the interventricular septum, upper part is fibrous. Upper part is, yes please, fibrous. And lower part is muscular. This is fibrous tissue. And lower part is muscular. Now, actually, fibrous tissue make a sleeve around these bundle branches, and this fibrous covering on the bundle branches are acting as insulating layer. You know, as you know, wires have the rubber sleeving. Electrical wires have a rubber on them. Rubber act as insulator. In the same way, when bundle branches are coming down, they are having fibrous cover on that, right? Act as insulator. Now, this is the ventricular septal myocardium. This is septal myocardium. Septal myocardium is stimulated by the left bundle branch. It is not stimulated by the right bundle branch. Why? Because there are some connections here, and left bundle branch gives stimulation to the septal myocardium. But right bundle branch takes the current downward, but it does not stimulate directly to septum. So it means myocardial septum is stimulated by the left side or by the right side? It is left side. So first there will be depolarization of left side of the interventricular septum. And this wave of depolarization will start from the left side of the septum, right? It is not only left side of the septum we stimulate, it is also stimulate the lower part of the septum. So we say wave of depolarization is produced in the ventricular septum in its lower and left portion. And this wave of depolarization sweeps from the left side, right side, and from lower to upper part. So this wave of depolarization moves from left to right and from down to up. So we can say that when ventricular septum is undergoing depolarization process, right, depolarizing currents are moving from left and lower portion of the septum towards right and upper portion. Is that right? Now, so we can make a vector of it. The vector of this septal depolarizing current, the depolarizing vector, is a small vector. Why? Because as compared to the big part of the ventricle, septum is having little myocardium. Is that right? So there is a small vector, but this vector is moving, yes, rightward and upward. Right? So this vector represents electrical activity of septal depolarization. Now you understand why the septal depolarization is a small vector? Because myocardial septum is a small tissue. Number one, it's small vector. Number two, this vector is directed rightward and upward because left bundle branch stimulate the left and lower portion of the myocardium. From there, current moves to rightward and upward. Right. So we can show in this diagram this vector. Right, and this vector is a small vector. Right, this is a small vector, depolarizing vector, and this vector represents which activity? Septal depolarization, which is rightward and upward. Do you think it's a moderate or slow conductor or fast conductor? Of course, it has Purkinje's system and that help it fast conduction. So we can say during the septal depolarization, the ventricular septal depolarization, electrical vector is generated, which is small but fast vector, which is moving rightward and upward, right? So how many electrical events we have discussed? Number one, atrial depolarization. When SA node fired, there was atrial depolarization, a small vector moving downward and leftward with moderate velocity, not fast velocity. Next electrical event was current was passing through AV node. But when current was passing through AV node, right, conduction was very slow and AV nodal tissue is extremely small, so electrical activity is not significant enough to move the ECG machine needle. So we say during the AV nodal conduction, heart is electrically silent. These are the first two events. Next event is onset of depolarization of ventricle. The first portion of the ventricle which undergoes depolarization is septum of ventricle. Septum of ventricle is depolarization produces a small vector moving rightward and upward, but it is not a slow vector, it is a very fast vector. Is that right? After that, now current will reach to the, it has passed through this area, it has stimulated the septum. Now there are branches coming out of Purkinje system. Is that right? There is right bundle branch and there is left bundle branch. right? Now wave of depolarization comes from these bundle branches and their Purkinje fibers to the ventricular myocardium. Let's suppose I show you that these are Purkinje cells. These two are Purkinje cells. And they are connected with, what are these? Myocardial cells. So naturally, first cell will stimulate the second in a fast way, and then that will conduct current to the third, then deposition will go to the fourth cell and fifth cell. A very important point to be noted. What is the very important point to be noted? That Purkinje fibers are in the deeper myocardium, right? Myocardium has two part. This myocardium, let's suppose this is myocardium innermost part, inner myocardium, this is the middle myocardium, and this is outer myocardium in the ventricles. This is called subendocardial myocardium because this myocardium is just under the endocardium and this myocardium is just under the pericardium. So some people call inner myocardium as subendocardial myocardium and outer myocardium as subpericardial myocardium, because here is your endocardium and here it is your pericardium. Is that clear? Now, the point we should be noted is that this Purkinje system, it is not in the middle of this. It is into very deep myocardium or inner myocardium. So which part of the myocardium will be first depolarized? That is the inner myocardium. Is that right? So depolarizing currents are generated in the major part of the ventricle first in the inner myocardium. Is that right? So inner myocardium is first stimulated and then depolarization moves outward. Again, because specialized conduction system is embedded in deepest most myocardium, or this specialized conduction system is very near to the deepest myocardium or inner myocardium, so inner myocardium is first stimulated and then wave of deposition moves outward. What does it mean? It means that first of all, these tissues are depolarized. Is that right? These are first depolarized. And then after that, wave of depolarization moves like this. What do you really see? That wave of depolarization is moving from inner myocardium to outer myocardium. Is that right? Now, another point which you have to note it, that left ventricle is 3 times thicker than the right ventricle. So naturally, depolarizing currents are produced in the left ventricle strongly, and as compared to the left ventricle, depolarizing currents and vectors are produced in the right ventricle relatively weak. Am I clear? Because left ventricle is thick. So depolarizing vector, let's suppose this is depolarizing vector. This is directed like this. It is a stronger vector. But here, because it is thin, so vector is smaller. And there's not one vector, many vectors are produced. Is that right? These vectors represent depolarization of right ventricle, and these are representing depolarization of, yes, left ventricle. Is that right? Now, all these vectors are produced almost simultaneously. And you know, when multiple vectors are produced simultaneously, they can be added together. So, when left ventricle is undergoing depolarization, right, we can make a single vector. This vector represents left ventricular depolarization. Is that right? And this vector represents right ventricular depolarization. You can see left ventricular vector is stronger and right ventricular depolarization vector is weaker. Is that right? Again, let me repeat it. Ventricle is depolarized in 3 stages. First of all, septum is depolarized, then left and right major ventricular portions are depolarized from end to out, and lastly, we'll discuss basal areas are depolarized. When left ventricle is depolarized, a vector is produced like this. And when right ventricle is depolarized, vector is produced like that. Now, left ventricular major depolarization vector is downward and leftward. Right ventricular depolarization is downward and rightward. But left ventricular vector is stronger and right ventricular vector is weaker. Because both of them are same time right? They are generated at the same times, so they can be added together. And if we add them together, this is the vector which represent the depolarization of, this vector represent the depolarization of major part of both ventricles. Is that right? Again, this vector is left ventricular depolarization vector, this is right ventricular depolarization vector, but because they are in the same time, so they can be added together, but because left ventricular vector is stronger and right ventricular vector is weaker, so net vector is directed downward and leftward. So this is the net vector representing the major ventricular depolarization, major left and right ventricular depolarization. Am I clear? And once septum is depolarized and major part of ventricles are depolarized, then eventually depolarization wave will reach to the basal area. These are the basal part of ventricles. So they will be the last to be depolarized, and here depolarizing current is moving from, let me make the diagram more clear. Now, here the current will be moving from down to up and rightward. Here also it is moving upward and rightward. So there will be small vectors made by the depolarization process in the basal part of the ventricles. But these vectors are moving upward and rightward. Why it is so? Because again, why it is so? The reason being that this is moving upward and rightward, this is also moving upward and rightward. These two vectors represent ventricular basal depolarization. Base of the ventricle undergoing depolarization. This is the last depolarizing event in ventricular depolarization. These are small vectors moving upward and rightward. But remember, all these electrical vectors which are produced in the ventricle, these are fast vector, because ventricles have special fast conduction system which is called Purkinje system. Am I clear? Any question up to this? So what have we learned? That during one cardiac cycle, up to now, how many vectors are generated one by one? How many electrical events are generated one by one? Right? Okay, let me make this diagram again, but without much revision. Let's suppose I draw your heart here. These are left and right. Remember again, atrial ventricular, atrial myocardial tissue and ventricular myocardial tissue is separated by the fibrous septum. This is the fibrous septum, and the only one point through which the current can move from atria to the ventricle is through a healthy heart. Current can move through, AV node. Is that right? And of course, here is specialized Purkinje system. Again, now we put all the electrical events in perspective. First event was atrial depolarization, having a small vector moving downward and leftward with moderate velocity. This was first electrical event. Second electrical event was AV nodal silence. Third electrical event was, what was this? Septal. Now ventricular depolarization start. There are three vectors for ventricular depolarization. First, septal ventricular depolarization, then major ventricular depolarization, then basal ventricular depolarization. Septal ventricular depolarization make a small vector but moving rightward and upward, but fast vector. And what is this vector? This is vector representing major ventricular depolarization. Am I clear? And in the end, these small vectors represent what? Yes, basal ventricular depolarization. Am I clear? So these are the, now atrial depolarization is done by this vector. When then AV node is showing the silence, Then ventricular depolarization process start. When ventricular depolarization process start, at that very time, atria is undergoing repolarization. So repolarizing current in the atria is masked by the depolarizing activity in the ventricles, right? Now, let's suppose we go to the next stage. First electrical activity, second, third, fourth, and here is the fifth. Now, let's take this electrical graphs, electrical vectors, right, of this heart and apply a galvanometer there. You remember the galvanometer from last lecture? Let's see it. Here is this man. He's very happy. You know why he's happy? Because he understands the ECG to some extent now. So he's very, very happy. Okay. Right? I've shown a very big heart there, but actually heart is of course smaller. But what I'm showing that this is the heart of this person. These are the electrical events in his heart during one cardiac cycle. I have not shown the ventricular repolarization. That I will discuss later, right? Now, what we do, we apply our galvanometer to this person and see what are the needle fluctuation due to these vectors. It will be fun. Now, let's suppose that here is our galvanometer and we break down its window and take its needle out. This is that galvanometer. Here it has, we apply, let's suppose, positive electrode on the foot, left foot. Suppose we apply the positive electrode here and we apply the negative electrode. What is this? Right arm. So the same galvanometer we have applied to this person and we want to see what type of needle fluctuations are produced by the electrical activity of the heart. Because when during one cardiac cycle, electrical vectors are produced due to electrical events. And these electrical vectors and electrical potentials are very faithfully conducted to the body surface through the body fluids. The very small electrical activity of the heart produces very miniature voltages up to skin. Body is a very good volume conductor. Right? Even very small electrical currents which are produced during the one cardiac cycle or each cardiac cycle, they are very faithfully conducted up to the body surface. It is such a volume, good conductor. If you don't trust that body is a good conductor, you can do a small experiment. Put your finger into any electrical plug. Suddenly you will know that body is a very good conductor. Take care, don't do it anywhere. Right? Now listen. So electrical activity of heart comes to the body surface. So we can apply the electrode on the body surface and pick up the electrical activity which is going on deep into heart. Is that right? Now listen. We have applied the positive electrode on the foot because it is convenient to apply here. But actually, whatever electrical current is coming to this point, this will be conducted to the foot. So it means applying the electrode to the foot is equivalent to applying the electrode at the junction of the left lower limb and the trunk. In the same way, when you apply the electrode on the right arm, actually position of the electrode will sense the same electrical activity which electrode could sense when electrode is applied at the junction of right upper limb and the trunk, right? Again, let me repeat it. For key convenience, I have applied the negative electrode here and positive electrode on the foot. Is that right? Basically, whatever electrical activity is here is the same which is conducted in the arm. So either you put electrode here or here, it will be doing the receiving the same result. In the same way, you apply the electrode here or you apply the electrode on the foot, right? What really happens, that electrical activity which is reaching here, right, that will be recorded. Is that right? Now, so for practical purposes, we can say that positive electrode which is on the foot is actually here, right? This is the positive electrode, and negative electrode which is on the right, what, right arm, right, this is practically here, right? Now these are the positions of the electrodes, and we have to see that how these vectors will move this needle. Let's do a little scientific work. What we do, we take a paper roll, roll of paper, and this is a roll of paper, is that right? This is paper roll, we put it vertically, and here let's suppose this is a wooden stand, and we have applied this paper roll on the stand. Is that right? We are making ECG machine by one moving paper roll and a galvanometer. That's the simplest form of ECG machine. Here is a small motor, and this motor is constantly moving the paper in this direction, right? So paper is moving in this way. Is that right? Paper is moving in this direction. Now what we do? We are ready with our ECG machine. This was galvanometer, very sensitive one. Put positive electrode here, here, negative electrode on the right side of the trunk, right upper side. Clear? More truly speaking, on the right arm. Now, we brought this needle out, and let's suppose on this needle tip we put some black ink. We put a black ink. Is that right? And we make the switch on, and this paper start moving under the needle. When this paper is moving under the needle, if there is no electrical activity in the heart, listen now carefully, rather you have to answer. If there is no electrical activity in the heart, right, no vectors are there, do you think this needle will fluctuate or it will remain at a steady point, neutral position? So when there is no electrical activity in the heart, these electrodes don't sense anything, needle remain at the neutral position. Because paper is moving under the needle, so it will make a straight line. Is that right? Then suddenly SA node fires. Suddenly SA node fire. And first electrical event start. That is the spreading of depolarization on atria. And which electrical vector is produced? Atrial vector is produced. What is produced? Atrial vector is produced. When this atrial vector is produced, this atrial depolarizing vector is moving towards the positive electrode or away?
Towards.
It is moving towards the positive electrode. So deflection should be positive. You know that when positive charges move to the positive electrode, deflection will be positive. So needle will move upward. Remember that this side is, this is zero position. Here it is positive side and this is negative side. Deflections which are upward, they are positive deflection. Deflections which are downward, they are negative deflection. So when atria is undergoing depolarization, a small vector is moving towards the positive electrode, so there will be small positive deflection. And it is moderate velocity. So this will be, needle will go upward positively with moderate speed, not fast speed. So as paper is moving under it, so during atrial depolarization, when needle is gradually lifted upward, as this vector is moving towards the positive electrode, this wave will be generated on the paper. This wave represent what thing? Atrial depolarization. This wave is generated by the needle in response to atrial depolarizing vector, right? And this is a slow wave, not a fast wave. Is that right? And a small deflection because atrial vector is small one. What is the next electrical event? Now atrial completely depolarize. When atrial completely depolarize, needle will come back to neutral position. Clear? Now the next electrical event is, what is this? AV nodal depolarization. When AV node is undergoing depolarization, do you think there is any significant current which will move the needle? No. So we say this electrically, heart is silent. We say this AV nodal silence. So when current is conducting through AV node, these electrodes don't pick up any activity, so needle will remain straight. So after the end of the atrial depolarization and before the beginning of ventricular depolarization, current is held in AV node, but that current activity is so small that needle is not, electrode don't sense anything, needle will not move, so there will be a straight line. So this straight line represents that needle is not fluctuating. Why the needle is not fluctuating? Because right now current is passing through AV node, and AV node is a small tissue. Electrical activity is so small, the needle does not fluctuate. Is that right? So this small piece, right, this represents conduction through AV node. Is that right? What is the next electrical event? Suddenly, current is released into Purkinje system. As soon as current is released into Purkinje system, ventricular depolarization start. Depolarization wave spreads through the ventricle. The first electrical event is septal depolarization. Now, when ventricular septal is undergoing depolarization, a small vector is produced. So there will be small deflection. But this vector is moving towards the positive electrode, or this vector is moving away? Because this vector is moving away from the positive electrode, so deflection will be negative, but small deflection. And because it is fast vector, so there is small deflection, which is negative, but slow or fast? Fast. So needle will move when ventricular depolarization is there. Needle will move fastly, a little deflection down, and then come back. So when it will rapidly move, it will make a wave like this. So this wave, this needle fluctuation represent ventricular septal depolarization. Is that right? The first wave is called P wave. So P wave represent atrial depolarization. After that, this straight line represent conduction through AV node. Then this is showing the onset of ventricular depolarization, and the small but fast negative wave, here it is representing what? Ventricular septal depolarization, right? Now, what is the next electrical event? Next electrical event is current is going now to the major part of the both ventricles. And both ventricles, when major ventricular depolarization is started going on, now the next electrical event is, after the septal depolarization, there is major ventricular depolarization. During major ventricular depolarization, a very strong vector is produced downward and leftward, strong and fast. The strong and fast vector, which is representing the electrical activity in major ventricular depolarization, this vector is moving towards the positive electrode or away? It is moving towards the positive electrode. So deflection will be negative or positive? It will be positive, because positive charge is moving towards the positive electrode. So deflection will be positive, number one. Number two, deflection will be slow or fast? Fast. And deflection will be small or big? So what happens? Strong, big deflection in a fast fashion. So when needle, when major ventricular depolarization is going on, a very strong and fast vector approaching the positive electrode, needle suddenly move strongly, positively, but fastly. So needle slowly move upward and comes down. So this wave is, this is called R wave, and this wave is due to major ventricular depolarization. This R wave is produced by the sudden upward deflection of needle, and this deflection is fast. It reaches rapidly to the peak and come down. And what is it is representing? It is representing the major ventricular depolarization, which is strong depolarization but fast depolarization, and deposition is moving downward and leftward toward the positive electrode. So because deposition is moving towards the positive electrode, deflection is positive. Because it is strong vector, so deflection is high amplitude, and because fast vector, so deflection is sudden up and down. Am I clear? After that, what is the next electrical event? Next electrical event is the last electrical event in spread of ventricular depolarization. So last electrical event is, now current goes to the basal part of the ventricle. When depolarizing current reaches basal part of the ventricle, it produces small vectors which are moving upward and rightward. Now listen carefully. These basal ventricular depolarization produces small vectors which are moving upward and rightward. So these vectors are moving towards the positive electrode or away. So when these vectors are generated, they are moving away from the positive electrode, they will produce a negative deflection. And because these are small vectors, so they will produce small negative deflection. And fast vector, so there will be small negative but fast deflection. So needle will move a little down and then back. So that will produce small negative deflection. Is that right? And this is S wave. So S wave is representative of basal ventricular depolarization. Now let's look at whole this complex. There are three waves, Q, R, S. Three waves together are called Q, R, S complex. Again, listen. Q wave represent here in this study which we are doing. Q wave is representing ventricular septal depolarization. R wave shows that depolarization spreading over major ventricular part, and S wave is showing that depolarization spread into basal ventricular part. Am I clear? Up to this? Now, I will make one more diagram to make your concept more clear, and let's suppose we take the paper roll up to this point. Okay, then this frame also needs to be extended. Okay. Our ECG machine has a larger paper to see the other events also. Listen, let me make it very simple here. That, okay. We'll make a. The first electrical event was atrial depolarization. This was your atrial depolarization, right? This is represented by the, this vector is represented by the P wave. The second electrical activity was AV nodal, yes, AV nodal silence. This is represented by a straight segment at the end of the P wave and before the onset of QRS. Then there is ventricular depolarization. Ventricles are depolarized at three stages. Right. First of all, septal depolarization. Right. Then there is major ventricular depolarization. And then there is basal ventricular depolarization. When depolarizing current is spreading over ventricular septum, Q wave is produced. When depolarization is spreading over major part of the ventricles, which wave is produced? R wave is produced. And when depolarization is spreading into last part of the basal ventricle, which wave is produced? S wave is produced. It means during the QRS, depolarization is spread over all the ventricle. What has happened? Depolarization has spread from the septal area, from major part to the basal area. It means now both ventricles are completely depolarized, right? If both ventricles are completely depolarized, I will show the diagram here. This is right ventricle, this is left ventricle. Now, at the end of QRS, you can say that both ventricles are completely depolarized. It means the septum is completely depolarized. The major portions are, yes please, completely depolarized. And these are positive charges I'm drawing. And even the basal parts are also completely depolarized. So electrically, at the end of the QRS, whole ventricle, septal area, major area and basal area, all the complete ventricular tissues completely depolarized. Now, if you remember the first lecture, if a tissue is completely depolarized, do you think any current is moving in the tissue? No. So after the QRS, when ventricles are completely depolarized, there is no more current moving. And if there is no current moving, do you think this needle will move? Attention please. At the end of the QRS, when all the ventricular tissue is completely depolarized, do you think there is any current further moving? There is no vector there, no current moving. So until this remains completely depolarized, needle will not show any fluctuation. It will remain at neutral position and it will be a straight line. This will be a, yes please, this will be a straight line. So it means QRS represent the spread of depolarization in the ventricular tissue. And this straight line, later on we'll talk, tell the straight line, ST segment. This straight line is made because there is no electrical activity in the ventricles and all of the ventricular tissues completely depolarize. Then of course, what happens after depolarization? Onset of repolarization. So after some time, repolarization process will start, and in the ventricles, repolarization start from outer. Okay, I will make the next diagram, that is much better. This is your completely depolarized ventricle, right? Now I show you the onset of ventricular repolarization. Actually, when ventricle is completely depolarized, the repolarization start, okay, this is the depolarized ventricle completely. In the ventricle, the rule is that the part which is depolarized last repolarizes first. You remember that inner part of the ventricle was depolarized first and depolarization moved from in to out. Now, the first area which will undergo repolarization is outer area. So, outer shell of this is getting repolarization. I'm showing the repolarization by negative sign. You remember that in depolarization, positive ions move, cations move inside the cells, and during repolarization, positive ions move out. You remember in depolarization, sodium moves in, and during repolarization, potassium moves out of the cells. So what really happens? That at the onset of repolarization, outer myocardial cell start losing the potassium from the cell to the extracellular fluid. When potassium start coming out of the cells, cells again become electronegative, or we say they are again polarized negatively, or we say cells are repolarized. As soon as ventricular repolarization start from inside, outer part of the ventricle, and then repolarization spreads. After some time, you will find that now middle part of this is also repolarized. So we can say that repolarization is moving from out to in, from outer part of the myocardium to, yes please, inner part of myocardium. It means the direction of repolarization is exactly opposite to the direction of depolarization, because depolarization was in to out, and repolarization is, yes, we can focus it, depolarization is from inside to outside, and repolarization is outside to inside. Is that right? So it means depolarizing vector should be out to in. And if you make all these vectors combined together, the net repolarizing vector will be directed like this. This is the net repolarizing vector. The only very important thing is that in the head of the vector we have electro negativity. So repolarizing current is moving out to N. If all these vectors are put together, so repolarization is moving rightward and upward. As major ventricular depolarization was moving, major ventricular depolarization was moving downward and leftward, repolarization is moving rightward and upward. Now there are two questions. Number one question is, why outer ventricular myocardium repolarizes first and why the inner myocardium repolarizes last? Let me tell you. Actually, during QRS and ST segment, ventricles were in systole. Mechanically, ventricles were contracting. When ventricles contract, now let me make one more diagram. Let's suppose this is one ventricle. Left ventricle only. This is the inner part of myocardium. This is the middle myocardium. This is the outer myocardium. Right? And let's suppose these are the capillaries. What are these? Blood flow capillaries. It means the blood flow or capillary beds are in inner myocardium, middle myocardium and outer myocardium. When ventricle contracts strongly, the inner capillaries or in inner capillary beds are compressed between outer and outer myocardium and the blood. Again, when ventricle squeezes the blood, when ventricle produces systole, right, then what happens? That outer myocardium compresses the middle myocardium and inner myocardium because contraction is inward. So what will happen? That blood flow in inner myocardium will be stopped. Right? But blood flow to outer myocardium will be better than inner myocardium. Because blood flow is maintained better in outer myocardium during the systole, so repolarization starts from the outer myocardium. Right? So again, depolarization move from inner myocardium to outer because depolarizing current is supplied by the Purkinje system, which is more near to the inner myocardium. But repolarizing current move from out to in because outer myocardium has a better blood supply during the systole as compared to the inner. Am I right? Secondly, during depolarization, we find there are three vectors. But during repolarization, we are making only one vector. Why? The reason being, depolarization is a fast process, but repolarization is a slow process. Because sodium channels are fast channels, but potassium channels are not that fast. So again, listen. Depolarization occurs fastly, and repolarization occurs gradually. Is that right? Now, when depolarization is going on, septal depolarization suddenly occurs and complete. Then major ventricular depolarization comes. And when major ventricular depolarization is completed, then basal ventricular depolarization comes. So depolarizing vector for septum and major part and basal part are recognized by the needle independently. So three independent waves are made. Is that right? Am I clear? Again, let's come back to this diagram. That during the repolarization, depolarization, septum is depolarized first. Major part is depolarized and lastly basal. Because depolarization is a fast process, so first septal depolarization completes, then vector is produced for major ventricular depolarization, and very rapidly this vector is complete and then basal vectors are produced. Is that right? So machine will sense septal vectors, major ventricular depolarization vector and basal vectors independent of each other. So it will draw three waves. Clear? But repolarization is a slow process. Now listen carefully. When septum is depolarizing, yet repolarization is a slow process. When septum has started its repolarization, it has not finished, major ventricular repolarization start. And it has not finished, basal repolarization start. So because repolarization is a slow process, so three areas of the ventricles, when they start the repolarization, their repolarizing currents are overlapped in their time. When septal repolarization, major ventricular repolarization and basal repolarizing vectors, they are almost overlapping with each other, then the strongest vector will move the needle. And strongest vector is major ventricular repolarization. Is that right? Septal repolarization and basal repolarization is fused with it. Am I clear? So repolarizing current makes a single important vector which is moving rightward and upward, carrying negative current in its head. Am I clear? No problem? Now let's go back to this diagram. I have not drawn here repolarizing vector. With your permission, I draw here repolarization vector, but not in green color. I draw it in black color. This is the repolarization vector, and of course its head is electronegative. Is that right? Now ventricles are repolarizing. When ventricles are repolarizing, the vector is moving towards the negative electrode or away from the negative. There's a negative vector. There's a negative vector of repolarization moving towards the negative vector. So deflection should be positive or negative?
Positive.
Positive. Because rule was this, the positive charge move to the positive electrode, deflection should be positive. If negative vector move towards the negative electrode, deflection should be again positive, because similar charges moving towards the similar electrode. Am I clear? So during repolarization, needle will move positively, but repolarization is a moderate speed process. So needle will move fast velocity or gradually?
Gradually.
So when repolarization vector is moving, because it's a gradual vector and a negative vector moving towards the negative electrode, so needle move positively but gradually. So when needle will move positively but gradually, so during repolarization, a wave is produced, positive but gradual wave. And this wave is called T wave. And this T wave represent, what is this? Ventricular
repolarization.
This T wave represents ventricular repolarization, right? Now, let's recap all of it. P wave represent atrial depolarization. This piece, this isoelectric line, let me tell you what is isoelectric line. Isoelectric line is a straight line when needle is not fluctuating. So this isoelectric line, a straight line at the end of the P wave and starting at the end of the P wave and terminating at the beginning of QRS complex is called PR segment. What is this called? PR segment, which is starting at the end of the, this segment is starting at the end of the P wave and the beginning of the QRS complex. Ideally, it should be called PQ segment, but in some readings, Q wave is not seen. So they call it PR segment. So this PR segment is representing which activity? AV nodal electrical activity, AV nodal delay. Q wave is showing the onset of ventricular depolarization, and it specifically represents ventricular septal depolarization. R wave is representative of major ventricular depolarization. S wave is representative of basal ventricular depolarization. At the end of the QRS and at the beginning of the T wave, this straight line is called ST segment. What is this segment called? ST segment. ST segment is representing that which electrical activity? It represents the time during which all the ventricle is completely depolarized and yet repolarization has not started. Is that right? Then the T wave. T wave represent ventricular repolarization. So what we see, QRS represents spread of ventricular depolarization. ST segment represent when ventricles remain completely depolarized, and T wave represent ventricular repolarization. Am I clear? But remember, P wave was showing atrial depolarization, but there's no wave and no fluctuation there showing the atrial repolarization. Why? Because when atrial repolarizing, at that time QRS complex is being formed, and atrial depolarization is weak electrical activity, but QRS complex, which is representative of ventricular depolarization spread, QRS complex is a very strong electrical activity, so atrial repolarization is masked. It is covered and it is unable to move the needle independently. So atrial repolarization is not presented during the ECG tracing. Is that right? So what we have done in all this lecture, again, listen, we have done number one. During one cardiac cycle, what are the electrical events? Step number two, how those electrical events produce the electrical vectors? And step number three, how different electrical vectors, which are called cardiac vectors, how those cardiac vectors produce ECG pattern? Is that right? Let's have a break. So, dear student, up to now we have learned that how the normal electrical activity in the heart produces different cardiac vectors and how the normal cardiac vectors produce the normal ECG pattern, right? Let's recap it and then we'll talk about different waves, segments and intervals. Let's suppose that this is a typical ECG. Let's suppose this is a typical ECG pattern, right? First, we relate the different parts of the ECG with the cardiac events, right? Suppose this is your heart. Now, this is P wave. The cause of P wave is atrial, yes please, atrial depolarization, right? So this is the atrial depolarization, right, which is related with the P wave. So what is the significance of P waves? Atrial depolarization. Then we come to, what is this? ST segment, isoelectric line, a straight line between the, at the end of the P wave and beginning of the QRS complex. The straight line, right, which is called ST segment, that signifies and other cardiac electrical event, and that is when current is passing through, yes, AV node. When current is passing through the AV node, you remember I told you when current is passing through AV node, electrical activity is so small that it is not detected by the electrodes, and due to that reason, needle does not fluctuate. And as paper is passing through a steady needle or neutral needle, a straight line is drawn. Right? So this was the second electrical event in the heart, that current from the atria passing through the AV node towards the ventricle. Is that right? And this straight line is signifying the conduction of the cardiac impulse through the AV node. Then we come to QRS complex. Right? So we have, these are three waves, so we have to make three heart signifying three electrical activities. Right. Now, Q wave tells the onset of spread of depolarization current in the ventricle. As you know, that first of all, this is the ventricular septum which undergoes depolarization. And ventricular septal depolarization is a small vector which is moving upward and, yes, rightward. Is it clear? And this vector is making which wave? Yes, please. Q wave. Is that right? Then once the ventricular septum is depolarized, the next event is major ventricular depolarization. And during the major ventricular depolarization, a very powerful electromagnetic vector is made, right? Which is directed downward and leftward, right? This is the vector of major ventricular, yes, major ventricular depolarization, right? And this vector, because it's a strong vector, so it makes a very strong wave, and because it is moving towards the positive electrode, so there's upward deflection, and it is fast vector, so there's a sharp wave. Right? So we can say this electrical event is responsible for which wave? R wave. You must know how to define QRS. In QRS complex, the first negative wave is called Q. And after the first negative wave, whichever positive wave is there, that is called R. And after the positive wave, if there is another negative wave, that is called S. Is that right? Of course, once septum is depolarized, you get the Q wave. When major ventricular depolarization is there, you get R wave. And when there is, yes, this is the next wave, when there is basal ventricular depolarization, what is this? Yes, basal ventricular depolarization, the last part of the ventricle to be depolarized, right? And they lead to which type of, yeah, wave? What is this wave called? S wave. Is that right? Then the next electrical event is that the whole ventricle is now completely depolarized. Whole ventricle is now, yes, completely depolarized. I mean, septum is depolarized. Major part of ventricles are also depolarized. And basal part of ventricle are also depolarized. Is that right? In action potential, QRS complexes, QRS complexes with onset of spread of ventricular depolarization. But at this straight line is called ST segment. During the ST segment, all the myocardial cells are depolarized. Is that right? They are passing through plateau phase. And rapid repolarization stage is yet not there. Is that right? Due to that reason, when all the myocardial cells in the ventricles are completely depolarized, there is no movement of the current. So there is no electrical vectors present. So nothing to be recorded by the electrodes. So what happens? That ECG machine needle does not fluctuate, it remains neutral. And as paper is moving under it, it makes a straight line. At the end of the straight line, what really happens? Suddenly, there is beginning of ventricular repolarization. Right, the next event is the beginning of ventricular repolarization. Okay, let me make the ventricle a little bit thicker to show how the repolarization start. And what was this? During the plateau phase. Now, we are going to talk about this wave, from where the T wave comes. Actually, the onset of T wave tells you there is beginning of ventricular repolarization. Right? And if you remember that when ventricles are completely depolarized, the repolarizing current start from outer, yes, this green is the repolarizing current. Repolarizing current is development of electronegativity, that cells repolarize back to the negative polarity. Is it right? This is electronegativity or repolarization, right, which is spreading from outer myocardium towards the inner myocardium. Because repolarizing currents move in this direction from outer to inner myocardium, this is the repolarizing current. So their net vector is like this. This is the vector of repolarizing current. And of course, there is no spread of positive charges, rather there is loss of positive charges, that is potassium from the cells, and there is development of electronegativity in the cell. So head of the vector is electronegative, and now negative charges are moving towards the negative electrode, so deflection will be positive. But repolarization is a gradual process, so needle will move positive side but gradually, so it will not make a sharp wave, it will make a slow wave, right? So now you know that T wave is representing which activity? Yes, please. Ventricular repolarization. This represents ventricular repolarization. Is that clear? Now, if there is a one ventricular cell, let's replay. This is one ventricular cell, right? For example, this is single cell which represents all the ventricular activity. Let's correlate these ventricular waves and segments, right, with the electrical event. During the QRS, what is happening to the ventricular cells? There is opening of sodium channels. And what is going on? There's a heavy sodium influx. And what is happening? Depolarization is happening. Here is your resting membrane potential, and here is your threshold potential. So at the beginning of the QRS in the ventricle, resting membrane potential approaches, yes, threshold, and then what opens? What is this? Fast sodium channel or voltage gated sodium channels. A lot of sodium comes in. What is happening? A lot of sodium is, yes please, coming into cells. So cells are being loaded with the sodium during the QRS complex formation. Is that right? During this ST segment, what is happening? That potassium loss has started. Potassium loss has started. Potassium channels are working, as well as calcium channels are also working, right? It means that potassium is going, yes, potassium channels open, so potassium is going out. But at the same time, calcium channels are also open, so what is coming in? Yes, please. Calcium is coming in. So naturally, this calcium will trigger the further release of calcium from intracellular stores, and contraction will start. Is that right? And there's a plateau in ventricular action potential. Is that right? Now let's do the timing. When myocardial cells are undergoing the onset of depolarization on ECG is represented by QRS. And after the depolarization, complete depolarization, there is plateau phase. During the plateau phase, calcium channels are open as well as potassium channels are open. Potassium is going out of the cell and calcium is coming into the cell. So myocardial cells are losing the cations as well as gaining the cations. So electrical potential is not changed, it remains stable. But by the end of this ST segment, suddenly calcium channels stop. Calcium channels become closed. But potassium channels become further open. Is that right? These are the potassium channels. So what really happened, that as time passes by, now you see calcium channels are becoming off after this point. But potassium channels are progressively opening further. So there's heavy potassium loss. And this heavy potassium loss leads to which event? Repolarization event, that now it should match with repolarizing event, right? So now you can correlate the electrical event in myocardial cells and the electrical events shown on the ECG. Again, let's recap. Myocardial cells are undergoing depolarization process. Action potential is showing upstroke, which is called zero phase of depolarization. And that very time, ECG recording is showing QRS complex. So whenever you see next time in your life QRS complex, it means that that very moment the needle is making QRS complex, ventricle cells are undergoing depolarization. When you see ST segment, then action potential is in plateau phase, and when the T wave is there, that signifies repolarization. Is that right? Now you can see in three ways correlate the things. Number one, electrical events in the cell, action potential, vectorial analysis, and ECG pattern formation. Is it clear? Now, after this discussion, I want to discuss the different types of waves, segments, and intervals related with the ECG recording. Now, I will show you the waves, then I will show you the segments, and then I will show you important intervals. Now, first of all, how we define waves? Waves are produced due to deflections of the needle during the ECG recording. For example, when needle is deflected upward, P wave is formed. So P is a, this is a wave. In the same way, this is produced through deflection down. So this is a wave. This is deflection up. This is a wave. right? In the same way, deflection down, this is a wave. So what are waves? Waves are the pattern made on the ECG recording due to fluctuation of the needle. Is that right? Now, which waves we can see in this diagram? If this is normal ECG, number one, you can see the wave. What is this wave? First of all, up to this?
P wave.
P wave. What is this? P wave. Then, the next wave is Q wave, immediately followed by R wave, and then followed by S wave. Many times, these three waves are put together, and in the beginning of the Q wave and up to the end of the S wave, this duration, this is Q, R, S complex, or total duration of Q, R, S complex is also called Q, R, S interval. What is this called? Q, R, S interval, because Q is a single wave, R is a single wave, S is a single wave. But when these three things are put together, they can be called interval, right? So this is signifying three waves together, that is Q, R, S interval. Then there is no fluctuation, so it is not a wave. But there is again fluctuation, so this will be, yes, called T wave. T wave. So how many waves do you have in normal ECG? P wave for atrial depolarization. Remember, atrial repolarization does not make a wave, because when atria is undergoing repolarizing process, at that very moment, ventricular depolarization is making QRS complex. So very weak atrial repolarizing current is masked by the ventricular depolarizing currents. Is that right? So we see atrial depolarizing wave, but we do not see atrial repolarizing wave. Then next is QRS wave, the spread of depolarization in the ventricle, QRS interval of waves. Then T wave, that is the, what is that?
Ventricular
repolarization. Now, in between the waves, you find that they are straight line. There's one this straight line, right? And there's another straight line here. These straight lines are also called isoelectric line. Why? Straight lines are drawn by the needle when needle of the machine is not fluctuating. It means it is not recording any electrical activity. Is that right? So we say there is isoelectric event during which needle is not moving, and but paper is moving under the needle. So it makes a straight line. So what is this? This is isoelectric line. This is another isoelectric line. These isoelectric lines are the lines, or isoelectric segments are the segments in between the waves, and these segments are drawn when there is no fluctuation of the needle, when electrodes are not recording any significant electrical activity in the heart. Am I right? Now, this isoelectric line, or this segment, we start at the end of the P wave and ends at the beginning of QRS complex, is called PR segment. What is it called? PR segment. Ideally, it should be called PQ segment. But when we change the position of the electrode for different leads, sometimes Q wave is not drawn. Due to that reason, conventionally, doctors started calling the segment between the P wave and the QRS complex as PR segment. Is that right? So PR segment is a straight line which signifies which electrical activity? When current is passing through? AV node. This is PR segment. Then you have one more segment here. At the end of the QRS complex and at the beginning of T wave. So this is called S T segment. ST segment is the straight line which is drawn when spread of ventricular depolarization is terminated and yet rapid phase of repolarization has not started. There is a plateau phase, cations are going into cell as well as cations are coming out of the cell, no significant electrical changes in the potential. So electrode do not record any significant electrical activity in the heart. Due to that reason, needle remains static, it does not fluctuate, and a straight line is made. So during the ST segment, what is really there, that whole myocardium in the ventricle is completely depolarized and there is no current moving, no vector moving through the ventricle. Is it clear? Now, we have talked about the waves which are produced due to fluctuations of the needle. We have talked about segments which are isoelectric lines. Is that right? Let's talk about interval. Intervals are sum of some waves and segments, or more than one wave together are called intervals, or some wave plus segment is called interval. Let me tell you. If we measure from here, from the beginning of the P wave up to the beginning of the QRS complex, up to here. Now this duration, right, from the beginning of the P wave up to the beginning of the QRS, whole this duration, I mean this duration, this is called PR interval. You must know the difference in PR segment and interval. PR segment is only this isoelectric line, but PR interval include the P waves. The difference in PR segment and PR interval is, PR interval has P wave plus PR segment, but PR segment has no wave involving in it. What does it mean? What is the real difference? That during the PR segment, there is only conduction through the AV node. But if we are talking about PR interval, it means we are talking about the spread of depolarization in the atrium plus conduction through the AV node just before the onset of ventricular depolarization. Is that right? So we can say that PR interval, what this should be called, PR, yes, interval, is a duration during which current start from SA node depolarizes atria, making the P wave, and then current has entered into AV node and passing through the AV node, during which current is making ST, current is making PR segment, right? And as soon as AV node releases the current into ventricle, machine start making QRS complex. So as soon as QRS complex start, PR segment, PR interval terminates. So PR interval is from the beginning of P wave up to the beginning of QRS complex. So it includes two electrical events, atrial depolarization plus conduction through AV node. But ST segment or PR segment signifies only AV nodal conduction. Now we come to the next interval. Next interval is, what is this? QRS. So QRS together up to here, QRS interval, because there is more than one wave, so this can be regarded as interval. Is that right? QRS interval is the duration during which current is spreading over ventricular tissue, septal ventricular spread, right? Current spreading over septum, major ventricular depolarization spreading, and basal depolarization. Is that right? Now we'll take another interval. That interval will start from here at the beginning of QRS, and this interval will end at the end of T wave. Now this duration from beginning of the QRS up to the end of T wave, it signifies how many things? It includes, number one, septal depolarization, major ventricular depolarization, basal depolarization, then the duration for which heart remains in plateau phase of action potential, and then onset and termination of repolarization. It means this interval, which is from the beginning of the Q wave and up to the end of T wave, this should be called Q T interval. What is it? Q T interval. Now what is the significance of QT interval? The significance or importance of QT interval is that it shows the beginning of ventricular depolarization and it ends up with the end of the ventricular repolarization. Whole ventricular depolarization and repolarizations are spanned during the QT interval. So next time when on ECG pattern you see that is the beginning of the QRS complex up to the T wave. So you know during this time action potential was generated and terminated in the ventricular tissue, and that is the time during which ventricular contraction was there, ventricular systole was there. Mechanically, ventricle was start contraction at this point and terminates contraction at this point. So if you really want to correlate the electrical events with the mechanical events, then from here you will show the onset of ventricular systole and here is the onset of ventricular diastole. Right? You can even correlate the heart sounds. Onset of ventricular systole closes the atrioventricular valve. So there will be first heart sound here. And onset of ventricular diastole closes which valves? Aortic and pulmonary, and there will be second heart sound here. So this is another relationship here. If you really want to learn it, then from this time up to this time, up to this time, ventricles are in systole. It means that ventricles are showing systole here, start contracting here, right? They keep on contracting. Right, and they keep on contracting and they keep on contracting, and when the contraction starts, there is first heart sound S1 ventricular systole, and the end of the ventricular systole is when diastole start, which sound come? S2, and in between the both of them, between S1 and S2, what is there? Systole, ventricular systole, and after that there is ventricular diastole. So how many things we correlate? Number one, first of all we saw what were the electrical activities in the heart. Then we translated electrical activities in heart into cardiac electrical vectors. Then from the electrical vectors we made the ECG pattern. Then we analyzed the ECG pattern into waves, segments and intervals. Then we really know that what are the significance of different waves and different segments and different intervals. Am I clear to everyone? Let's take a small break. Okay, before we really take a break, why don't we talk a small wave here. Sometimes there's a wave here, sometimes, and this is called U wave. What is this called? U wave. U wave is due to electrical activity in the papillary muscle. Why U wave come after the T wave? Sometimes the electrical activity in the ventricular papillary muscle is out of phase with the rest of the ventricle. So ventricular depolarization and repolarization terminate, and if there is after that there is electrical activity being shown in the papillary muscles of the ventricle, they may make small vectors which fluctuate on needle a little bit, and that may lead to the presence of U wave. You know where are the papillary muscles? Let me show you. If I make left ventricle, this is the left atrium, and here is mitral valve, and here is aortic valve. Is that right? Now, papillary muscles are the muscles which are attached like this here with the cauda tendini, and major function of the papillary muscle is that during the systole, during the ventricular systole, muscles should also contract so that mitral valve should close. You know, when ventricle contract, mitral valve closes. But if there are no papillary muscles, no cauda tendini, then due to strong contraction of ventricle, mitral valve may evert and blood may go back to regurgitate into atrium. But nature has provided the mitral valve with very special support, and these are cauda tendini, and which are attached with special muscles, and these are called papillary muscles. So when ventricles contract, papillary muscles also contract. So ventricular contraction closes the valves, papillary muscle prevent the eversion of valve, right? That valve may not be regurgitating, right? So electrical activity in these papillary muscles is sometimes out of phase with the electrical activity with the rest of the ventricle. Right? So due to that reason, sometimes that make an independent wave, and that is called U wave, right? Let's have a break. Now we will talk about the timings and duration of different ECG waves, different segments and intervals, right? You must be knowing that ECG pattern is drawn by the machine on a special calibrated paper, right? And that the calibrations on the ECG paper help us to determine the duration of different cardiac events, electrical events. Let's see how it really works. Let's suppose, you remember I told you that there was a, what was this, our galvanometer machine. In the beginning of the lecture I told you, and there was a pointer which was coming out, is that right? And there was an electrode here which was applied to a person with negative and positive ends. And now this needle fluctuates and draws the ECG pattern on a special paper. Now let me tell you something about that paper. Actually, this paper has vertical heavy lines, right? That is calibrated with heavy lines, right? And with red color, I'm drawing those heavy lines, right? Now, in the same way, there are also horizontal lines, not only vertical lines. We divide the paper into big squares. Now, this is a piece of ECG paper, right? And let's suppose that here is your pointer applied. Is that right? So naturally, the needle will fluctuate, that will draw the pattern on these squares. Is that right? Now, actually, during 1 minute, as I told you in the beginning, paper is moving under the pointer. Paper is moving under the pointer, right? This is the direction of movement of the paper. Is that right? And as during the cardiac cycle, different electrical vectors are produced in the heart, this needle will fluctuate and produce ECG pattern on the paper. Now, what is the speed of paper? Actually, during 1 minute, 300 big squares pass under the pointer. The speed of the paper, speed of the rolling paper is adjusted in such a way that during 1 minute, how many big squares pass under the pointer? 300 big squares pass under the pointer. It means all the electrical activity of the heart during 1 minute will be drawn over how many big squares? 300 big squares. Is that right? So we can say that 300 big squares represent 1 minute. 300 big squares, right? All the electrical activity which is drawn over 300 big squares actually represent how much duration of time? 1 minute. Or we can say that 300 big squares representative of 60 seconds. Am I clear? That during the 60 second, whatever electrical activity is, that is drawn on 300 big squares, or vice versa. The whatever electrical patterns are drawn on the 300 big squares, they represent how much, how many seconds? 60 seconds. Am I clear? Then the real question, one big square, if some waves are made over one big square, what is the time duration? That will be 60 divided by 300. Is that right? And if you calculate it, that will become 0.2 seconds. That will become 0.2 second. So it means today onward, you must remember, when you look at the ECG, whatever waves, interval or segment are present on one big square, they actually, those electrical activities occur during how much time? 0.2 second, 1/5 of a second. Is that right? Am I clear? So now onward, one big square is equal to how much time duration? Tell me please. 0.2 second. Is that right? It's simple up to this. Now, actually if you really look at the paper properly, you'll find that along these big squares, there are also small squares, right? And they're light lines. For example, there's a line here. So in every, in between two heavy lines, there are light lines. We divide it into five vertical columns. And these lines are not only vertical, they are also horizontal. Right? And in this way, every big square is divided into vertical columns, but when I will draw the horizontal lines also, then this every big square is divided into small squares. Right? Now you can see again. Let's suppose from here to here it is one big square. What was the time duration of one big square from here up to here? Yes, please. It is 0.2 second. Is that right? Every big square is equal to 0.2 second. But every big square is divided by the green lines or light lines. How many light lines? 1, 2, 3, and 4. And it divides the big square into how many small square? 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. It means that one big square is equal to 0.2 second. And we can also say that one big square is equal to how many small squares? 5 small squares. Is that right? Or we can say that 5 small square, right? If they are equal to one big square, and one big square is equal to how much time? 0.2 second. So one small square has how much duration? One small square is equal to 0.2 second divided by 5. Divided by 5. Look, one big square was how much duration? 0.2 second. And one small square will be how much time duration? This is a small 1/5 of the big square. Or big square time divided by 5. Big square time was 0.2 divided by 5. So that will become 0.04 second. And this is the most important timing you must remember. Today onward, as a doctor, you must remember one small square on ECG paper is equal to 0.04 second. Now you will tell me, one small square on ECG paper is equal to how much time? 0.04 second. This is the only thing which you have to remember, nothing else. Can you remember that? If you know from where this 0.04 second came, conceptually, I will repeat it. Under the pointer, paper is moving in such a way that during 60 seconds, how many big square pass? 300. And one big square is 60 seconds divided by 300, 0.2 second. And every big square has how many small squares? 5. So one small square is passed under the needle every 0.04 second. So every 0.04 second under the ECG pointer, how many small squares pass? One small. During every 0.04 second, a small square pass under the needle. Is that right? No question after this? Now I'll tell you the very easy thing. You know this ECG pattern, right? I will draw it. Okay, I draw ECG here. This needle start forming ECG. First of all, which wave will come?
P wave.
P wave. P wave take 2.5 small square. So this is the P wave. So P wave is drawn over how much time? 2.5 small square. After that, what is there? PR segment. After that, there is PR segment. That is also 2.5 small square. When your heart rate is about 72 per minute, P wave takes how much duration? 2.5 small square. PR segment take how much duration? 2.5 small squares. Is that right? Then, what does it mean? That what is the time duration for 2.5 small squares? Let's suppose one small square is equal to how much time? Please repeat it. One small square is equal to 0.04 second. Is that right? 2.5 small squares are equal to 0.04 plus 0.04 plus half mean 0.02. Total is 0.01 second. So it means 2.5 small square are how much duration? 0.1 second. 2.5 small square mean how much time duration? 0.1 second. If I say, listen now carefully, that in on ECG, if you find P wave is taking 2.5 small square, it means P wave is drawn over how much time? 0.1 second. It means current, electrical current from the SA node, it took 0.1 second to spread over both atria and reach to AV node. When current reach to the AV node, then needle will be static, neutral, and it will make PR segment. If PR segment is again for 2.5 small squares, it means that what is the duration of PR segment? 0.1 second. If duration of PR segment is 0.1 second, it means how much time is taken by the current to pass through AV node? 0.1 second. Is that right? Is it clear? So P wave is 0.1 second. PR segment is 0.1 second. Is that right? Both are on 2.5 small square. P wave, 2.5 small square for PR segment. It means if someone asks you tomorrow, what should be the duration of PR interval? PR interval means current starting from SA node, spreading of atrium, then passing through AV node. So that will be P wave plus PR segment. Look here. From the beginning of P wave up to the end of PR segment, now this duration from here up to here is P wave plus PR segment. It means whole this time duration shows that current was spreading on atria, P wave, and current was also passing through what? Current was also passing through AV node. So how much is the duration? 2.5 small square plus 2.5 small square. How many squares? 5 small square or 1 big square. How much time it become? 0.2 second, because 0.1 was for P wave and 0.1 was for PR segment, right? So total PR interval is sum of P wave plus PR segment. So PR interval is 0.2 second, of course with some variation from person to person. But just remember the middle values. So today onward, you remember number one, every small square is 0.04 second. Number two, P wave in normal heart with normal rhythm, is that right? Heart rate about 72 beats per minute. P wave takes how much? Squares? 2.5 small square. PR segment take how much small squares? 2.5 small square. Is it difficult to remember? Now, the most difficult is QRS complex duration. You know how much is that? 2.5 small square. QRS interval shows the current spreading on the ventricle, through ventricular septum, through major part of the ventricular areas and basal ventricular area, right? When QRS complex is coming, that again takes 2.5 small square. So this is your QRS complex. Normally it is drawn over how many small squares? 2.5 small square. So what is the duration? 2.5 small square mean 0.1 second. So it means what is the duration of QRS complex? 0.1 second. So if someone suddenly asks you that on this ECG paper QRS complex is drawn over 2.5 small square, then he asks you a question that when this ECG was being made and QRS complex is made because current was spreading over the ventricle, what was the total time duration during which current was released from AV node and it spreads through the septum and major ventricular part and basal ventricular part? You will say that duration of spread of current or depolarization in the ventricle is equal to the duration of QRS complex, and that if that is 2.5 small square, that must be how much time? 0.1 second. Is that right? So we have done 3 2.5 things. First 2.5 was P wave, second 2.5 was PR segment, third 2.5 was QRS complex. Or we can say P wave 0.1 second, PR segment 0.1 second, QRS interval 0.1 second. And if we talk about PR interval is P wave plus PR segment, so 0.1 plus 0.1 should be 0.2. Is it a big thing? Easy, right? So with on this patient, for example, this is a particular friend of you, and we this is an ECG on the paper, and this is his beautiful heart, because you like him, so he has a beautiful heart. But don't ask his ex-girlfriend how is his heart. Now listen, this was the heart, okay, this, why not, electrode should be up, this heart should be here, so that we know that electrodes are applied there. Of course, they are not applied directly on the heart, but just for simplicity, you draw it like this. SA node, yes, what is it? AV node. So this beautiful heart, when it was beating, this ECG tracing was made. Now we can correlate. If P wave is on 2.5 small square, atrial depolarization spread was 0.1 second. If PR segment is 2.5 small square, current was held in AV node for how much time? 0.1 second. If QRS complex is drawn over 2.5 small sec, 2.5 small squares, it means current released from AV node and spread over the ventricular tissue took how much time? 0.1 second. And if someone asks you how much time is taken by the total depolarization of atrium plus current passing through AV node, that is P wave plus PR segment equal to PR interval. 0.1 plus 0.1 is equal to 0.2. Is it difficult? So today when you go and find ECG, just look the waves and intervals they're drawn on how many small squares, and you know exactly what is there. Is that right? Now we have done 3 2.5, 2.5, 2.5, 2.5. So 3 2.5 makes 7.5. Am I right? You are intelligent enough to know that the 3 2.5 are equal to how much? 7.5. And if you put one more 2.5, how much it becomes? 10. Is it difficult to remember 10? 10 small squares? So up to now, 7.5 small squares are there. The next important whole activity is 10 small squares. What is that? The most important interval is now, this was PR interval, this was PR interval. From here, from the beginning of ventricular depolarization, and up to the end of ventricular repolarization, it takes 10 small squares. Let me tell you, QRS, again let me tell you, when current enters into ventricle, from that time, when current enters into, if it is released from the AV node, it will make QRS complex, then ST segment, and then repolarization will occur and it will make the T wave. So, onset of ventricular depolarization, up to the termination of ventricular repolarization. From the beginning of the ventricular depolarization up to the end of ventricular repolarization, what is drawn? QRS is drawn. Then what is made? ST segment is made. And then what is made? Yes, T wave is made. Hold this thing from this point up to this point is QT interval. Hold this thing, take 10 to 11 small squares. How many small squares? 10 to 11 small squares. So we say whole ventricular electrical activity is drawn over how many small squares? 10 small squares, just to memorize it, easy. 10 small squares are how much time duration? Of course, it's so easy. The 10 small square into every small square is equal to 0.04 is equal to 0.4 second. So what should be the duration of QT interval? QT interval. What should be the duration of QT interval? Yes, please. 0.4 second. Usually it is 10 or 11 small square. If you see that it has gone up to 11, for example, in some patient, T wave has gone up to this 11, then what is duration? 0.44 second. 0.44 second, 11. Is that right? So let's recap how we started the concept of timings and durations of different waves and segments and interval on the ECG paper, right? First, you have to remember, when you look at the ECG paper, one big square is how much time duration? Yes, please. 0.2 second. And one small square is how much time duration? 0.04 second. Say it loudly. Why you are afraid? One small square is equal to how much time? 0.04 second. Not difficult to remember. Now, next thing is very easy. It takes 2.5 small square. P wave is usually 2.5 small square. PR segment is 2.5 small square. QRS complex is 2.5 small square. But QT interval, we start from the beginning of QRS and terminate at the end of the T wave, takes how many small squares? 10 small squares. Now you know all the durations in every combination. Am I clear? Right? So the boys who are really sharp, they make it 2 to 3 small squares rather than saying 2.5. If you want to make a range, you know, our heart has not studied our book. And mostly the heart have not taken my lecture also. So they may slightly vary. They don't abide by these rules strictly. So if you are really very clever, you can say QRS complex may be 2 to 3 small squares. But actually you have to remember the central figure 2.5. So if someone asks, what is the duration of QRS complex? Right? You will calculate what is the duration of 2 small squares and 3 small squares. If someone asks you, what is the duration of P wave? Again, be diplomatic. Say P wave is, be thoughtful like a big cardiologist. P wave, I think it should be usually 2 to 3 small squares. Then you tell time duration. 2 small squares, you know that 0.08. And 3 small squares is 0.12. I think you know what. So you say, yes, I think P wave should be drawn over 0.08 second to, in some cases, up to 0.12 second. But if more than that, maybe there is some pathology. Are you understanding? But basic thing is same. The central figure is 2.5 for P wave, 2.5 for PR segment, 2.5 for QRS. And from beginning of the QRS up to the end of T wave is approximately 10 to 11. That's so easy. Am I clear? So this was some basic concept related with the timings of different waves, segments, and interval when you look at the calibrated ECG paper, right? So what we have discussed up to now in ECG, the whole concept of teaching you ECG was that this was a whole lecture about the very basics of the ECG, right? Basics of ECG means that I was not telling you the advanced ECG. First, you have to learn the basic ECG, that what are the electrical events in the heart, how different electrical events make different electrical vectors, and how those electrical vectors fluctuate the needle of ECG machine, and eventually how different ECG patterns are made, what are different waves, what are different segments, what are different intervals, and all these ECG patterns, waves, segments and intervals, they are related with what type of different cardiac electrical events. Is that right? But you must know, when electrical event in the heart, electrical activity in the heart becomes abnormal, then of course, heart develops normal cardiac vectors or abnormal cardiac vectors? Abnormal cardiac vector. And when heart develops abnormal cardiac vector, then of course, ECG pattern will also become abnormal. Is that right? So, about the abnormal ECG and arrhythmia, we'll discuss into detail, but in the future lectures related with the advanced ECG. That's all about the very basis of the ECG. Is there any question? No. Okay, good luck with your career in cardiology. Class dismissed.